Today, I'm going to attempt to give you a more definitive answer on what the best capture card is and how to use it to its fullest potential. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What is happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and it's been a while since I've done a streaming video, but after a full day of testing, I'm happy to report that I have some answers for you. So when I was researching the best capture card, I kept coming up with list after list that would have like 8 to 10 items on them, all geared towards gamers, and this wasn't really that helpful when I'm trying to figure out how to record the purest signal possible from my camera, and it also doesn't really make any sense that there could be 10 best capture cards. So I spent most of the last couple days trying different products in different configurations with different cameras to try and figure out what the best possible setup is for my usage scenario. So if you're anything like me, I hope this information will be really helpful to you. Anyway, I've got my notes that I wrote down during the testing, and I think I've got this pretty well figured out. So first up, here's my scenario. I've got a Windows 10 64-bit custom-built PC over here, and inside of it, I've got, I'm still running the i7-2600K Sandy Bridge. I've got that overclocked to 4.5 gigahertz, and my graphics card is from NVIDIA, which is important, and we'll get to that in a minute, but it's a GTX 970. So what I'm trying to do is capture one, maybe two, high-end cameras into my PC for streaming, so 1080p 30 will be fine. I don't plan on doing any, like, actual recording into the computer, so I don't really need 4K cards, and the only thing I will be recording is maybe, like, menus or setup configurations in case I want to do a tutorial on that, and I think 1080p will be fine for including that in videos. Now, for any of you gamers out there, that isn't to say that this information isn't going to be useful to you, it's just that there's other considerations you're going to have to make based on price and software. The options that I'm recommending might be a little bit pricey for a hobbyist gamer slash streamer, and I'm making no considerations for HDCP content protection, which I know that a lot of gamer streamers run into when they're trying to stream stuff from their like PlayStations or whatever, and it's violating the content protection on HDCP. This isn't going to address any of those issues. The cameras I tested this on was the Panasonic GH5 and the Sony A7 III, and I'm going to be making a follow-up video shortly that sort of talks about my experiences between those two cameras. So if you're using one of those cameras, you're thinking about getting or using one of those for streaming, you might want to check that video out when it's posted. Lastly, because this is a custom-built PC, I was targeting PCI Express cards over USB to help with latency, reduce cordage, and also reduce some reliance on drivers. For those that don't have this option, I will include some recommendations for USB devices at the end of the video. Okay, so with that scenario painted, with all of my usage cases laid out for you and what I was trying to do, the best capture card I can recommend for the money is the AverMedia LiveGamer HD2 PCI Express. And the best 1080p capture card I can recommend, period, would be the Magewell ProCapture HDMI, which also comes with a dual ProCapture HDMI if you want to run two cameras, and there's even a quad version, but that's a bit overkill for what I was looking for. The Magewells are just the best, open and shut, but the pricing is significantly higher than the AverMedia recommendation. For instance, if you're looking for just the HDMI one port one, it's $300 US or $400 Canadian, and the dual HDMI is $580 US or $770 Canadian, and the quad is like twice that, so let's not even talk about that. And they also have 4K cards which start at $500 US or $650 Canadian for like their basic 4K card. But the AverMedia, on the other hand, you get a lot of the same important features as the Magewell, but it's only $200 US or $270 Canadian. So now let's talk about what those important features are for people who want to capture a high quality feed from their nice cameras, and why that hardware that I mentioned inside the computer earlier is important. What's good about these specific cards that I mentioned is their ability to deliver an uncompressed signal into your computer. A lot of the other popular lines that you might see, like the ones from Elgato, for instance, they do a compressed signal when it comes into your computer. This is why the system requirements for those cards are generally higher and a lot more specified versus the cards that I'm recommending, because Elgato and the companies like them need to make sure that your computer is powerful enough to handle the compression that they have built into the card. They also rely heavily on their bundled software and drivers, which is why people have sort of varying degrees of success and compatibility. That being said, Elgato is probably the best when it comes to offering support for their bundled software and drivers and trying to find solutions to the common problems, unlike something like Blackmagic Design, which has cards that are very similar to the Mageable ones that I recommended, and I consider them for this review. I really wanted to love the Blackmagic deck link, but that garbage fan that they installed on the heatsink and the horror stories that you hear about their support just made it way too much to be able to recommend, even though they do offer probably the most competitive price for what you get. So back to compressed versus uncompressed. When you hook up a device to a computer that has compression on board on the card, as soon as you connect it, you're going to see your computer react in terms of usage. And this can be mild or significant depending on how powerful your computer is. This is why I mentioned having an NVIDIA graphics card earlier. Now, I'm sure this probably works on other NVIDIA graphics cards or even some other brands, but I've only tested it on like modern generation NVIDIA GPUs from the 900 series and beyond. But basically, when I connect an uncompressed signal to my computer using the Aver Media card, for instance, rather than see my CPU usage go up, my GPU usage goes up by just a modest amount and my CPU barely changes at all. But if I turn the GPU off, if I disable it, then my CPU usage kind of jumps back up like you would see if you were plugging in a card that had compression on board. But the advantage of this is that the uncompressed signal can kind of be pre-encoded by the GPU and have no effect on your CPU at all. And then when you actually go to record it locally or stream it, then your encoder options there kind of get a little bit more headroom. For instance, if I was going to stream using X264, the software encoder, which uses just the CPU, if I didn't have the GPU in there and I wanted to stream using my CPU at the setting very fast, that preset, the CPU usage goes up to like 55 or 60%, which is crazy. Like I couldn't possibly do that with two different cameras then at that amount. But if I have the GPU installed, because the sort of first stage of that is run through the GPU and then the final one is done through X264 with no loss because it's uncompressed coming in originally, and my CPU usage goes down only like 35%. So it's pretty significant on just having the GPU on board. And then further that, if I also do the streaming on the GPU using the codec NVENC, which doesn't use the CPU at all that happens basically is my GPU usage doubles to like 30-40% now, and my CPU still stays at like under 10%, allowing me to have multiple iterations of the setup with multiple cameras and multiple cards without, you know, having my CPU boil over and not be able to work or not be able to do anything else on my computer at the same time. That's why I think for this configuration that I'm recommending, having a modern graphics card is important to getting the best performance if you want to have a high-quality multi-cam setup. But it's also why it's important to have an uncompressed signal rather than having multiple cards all doing compression and sort of taking their own piece of the pie of your CPU outside of your control. You'd much rather have control and have a cleaner signal coming in, especially if you're using really nice cameras. I should mention that I was doing all of this with OBS Studio, by the way, which is my favorite program when it comes to sort of this kind of recording and streaming stuff. And I like it because it's able to use all these devices with very little meddling required with bundled software and drivers, which is another item that I should add to my list of usage conditions, which is that I didn't want to have to have too heavily reliant on bundled software or drivers. I wanted to just be able to plug it in, open up OBS, and then do it from there with less needing to launch different third-party programs and stuff like that. And the recommendations that I made are all very good for that, save for a couple notes I need to make on the Aver Media Live Gamer HD2 that did require some meddling with the drivers, even though the marketing software says it's completely driverless. Now, they're telling the truth, it is driverless. When I booted up my computer after installing the device, it was detected and it did work, but there were some things that you couldn't do that I would say doesn't make it completely driverless. For instance, if I tried to run the firmware updater to get the latest firmware on the card, it just wouldn't detect the card. And it's because the direct show driver that was just sort of in Windows that made it so I didn't have to download anything, that one didn't really integrate well with the firmware updater. So you need to download their software driver package, which is called like Rec Central 4 or something like that. And that will update the drivers to sort of the spec ones that the firmware updater is expecting to see and configuration tools expecting to see as well. And so once you have that installed, then you can go in, you can make some tweaks, you can update the firmware, you can get all that done, and then you can get rid of the software if you want after that. Some of the tweaks would be if you wanted to set your HDCP settings, like I was saying earlier, if you're doing some kind of content protection stuff, but that shouldn't matter to anybody that's just using their cameras to create original content. And then the other thing is that there's an LED problem, or at least I have a problem with the LED on the Aver Media. It's this bright blue light, and I really dislike it. And the only way to actually, I guess, disable it the right way is to use their software, and then you can decrease the brightness of the LED by 25% increments down to zero. Now, once all that's done, you should be able to safely uninstall the software, and you don't need it anymore if you plan to use OBS or something like that. I will say, though, that this did not fix the LED problem. Now, this is just a minor annoyance, but that light would only be configured when the program was running. So as soon as you rebooted your computer, the light would sort of recycle and be bright blue again. And then when you returned to Windows, it wasn't until after you launched the program again that then you would see the settings take effect. So unless you wanted to have that Rec Central software launch at boot every single time, which would obviously congest your boot up time, then the LED was just gonna do its own thing. And that obviously goes against the idea I was saying earlier where it's completely softwareless and you can just uninstall the software once you get all the updates done. That's not gonna allow you to do that. So I came up with a better idea. I uninstalled the software after configuring it, like I said, and I just took a piece of electrical tape and laid it on the diffuser that came with the LED so that you couldn't see the light shining through my case. Problem solved. Anyway, other than those issues, the Live Gamer HD2 is basically an uncompressed, softwareless, really, really great quality PCI Express card, very similar to the Magewell Capture Pro, but at a much reduced price. And it also has a 4K variant with HDR coming soon that is actually coming in at the same price as the 1080p version of the Magewell, which is $300 US or $400 Canadian. So to recap, if you're like me and you have a decent rig with a modern NVIDIA GPU and you want to capture a high quality, uncompressed signal from your camera, and you don't want to have to monkey around with bundled software drivers, and you want to just be able to use your favorite program like OBS, then get the AverMedia Live Gamer HD2. And if you need to hook up two cameras to a single card, or you just want to get the best possible card you can, then get the Magewell or the Magewell Dual. You really only need to know about those three cards that I mentioned. You can pretty much ignore the rest when it comes to PCI Express for this usage scenario, in my opinion. Lastly, as promised, if PCI Express is just not an option, and the only way you can get this to work is with USB, Magewell does have a USB variant of the PCI Express card, and it's called the Magewell USB Capture HDMI Gen 2. And it'll cost you about the same as the PCI version at $300 US or $400 Canadian. I've never personally tested it, but the majority of the reviews are favorable. The longevity of the device is the only thing that's really being brought into question in the negative reviews. I guess it won't last you as long as the PCI Express version, but that kind of makes sense based on the nature of USB devices. AverMedia's uncompressed USB option would be their Live Gamer Extreme, which is USB 3 and gives you 1080p 60. Of course, when it comes to USB devices, compatibility is an increased concern, so I recommend you go to AverMedia's website here and you can download this thing called the compatibility test tool, and it'll let you know if your system is a good fit. And again, having a modern NVIDIA graphics card will make the encoding process much smoother when it comes to dealing with uncompressed signals. I'm gonna include links for everything that we talked about today in the description below, so make sure you pop down there and take a look. And as I said, I'm gonna be making a follow-up video to this shortly, either later today or tomorrow, that describes my experiences in streaming with the GH5 and the A7 III. So if that's something that you might want to be considering doing, I highly recommend you check that video out as well. But that's going to be it for me. I hope you found this video helpful or at least entertaining, and if you did, make sure you leave it the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, feel free to hit the dislike button twice. All right, I'm done.